Welcome, everyone, to our monthly update meeting for cash. Finding seats. Got people at the back of the room. Good group today. Well, good morning, everyone. So nice to see you. I'd like to welcome our first-time attendees, if we have some. Anyone? Care to be embarrassed? No? Not today? Oh, hi. Welcome. Your name? Oh, welcome, Richard. Richard Rea with PBK Architects is here, first time, and we'll all be swarming around you, giving you good advice today. I know you've got someone who can do that for you right next to you. We are also broadcasting this meeting. Oh, I'm sorry. Where? Oh. Morgan, welcome. I would nominate her for cash chair. Morgan, how old are you? 10. Well, welcome. I hope your report turns out very well. I'm sure it will. And the cookies? Oh, yes, we have cookies. Yeah, Aunt Lindsay should, you know. Let her, yeah, it's kind of a special day. Let her go at it. So, all right, well, welcome. Anyone else that I'm missing? Okay. Tom, quit talking in the back. Okay, we are broadcasting this meeting live. So for those of you following online, thank you. I hope they can hear me okay. This mic is actually for the broadcast, so that's why I'm yelling at you. So let's get right to the updates. We've hosted a very successful workshop yesterday in Sacramento. I actually came in the afternoon and well attended, over 60 people, I think. If you missed it, we are having the same workshop in Ontario. So please join us. That would be Tuesday, January 31st at the Doubletree. And you can on-site register if you'd like. So very valuable. We went over governor's budget. The theme was new year, right? So new construction delivery legislation, new DSA IRs, and newly proposed Title V changes. So I think it was very informative, and I'd like to see you in Ontario if you can make it. We do have our weekly update email, so make sure to check your inbox and hopefully not your spam inbox. Update for the summary on the latest news for the organization, as well as the statewide effort on school facilities bond implementation. So Prop 51, you know, very important conversation today. Events, conferences, professional opportunities. If you're looking for a job, you're in a good job market. If you have any school facilities skill whatsoever, you're going to be in high demand and more. So that's a really important thing to check all the time to see what's going on. And we're going to go ahead and open up for state agencies, but I don't think Chet is here yet, so we're going to skip. And we'll go to Barbara from Office of Public School Construction, Camp Minor. And I don't think, Michael, you're not coming up? Okay, all right. Welcome, Barbara.
Thank you. All righty. Okay, good morning. Can you guys hear me okay in the back? Yeah, excellent. Okay, so we wanted to highlight a few things today. First thing to note, which you're probably all aware of, but we have our State Allocation Board meeting today at 4 o'clock. And as a reminder, that is in room 447 at the Capitol. And we will also be webcasting that if you are not able to attend in person. And we have some different reports to talk about in the board agenda today. But also in the executive officer statement, Lisa will be announcing that there is an opening of the charter school facility program filing round. There was $500 million made available for the charter school program in Prop 51. And the regulations currently in effect require that a new filing round be opened 90 calendar days after an election authorizing additional funding. So that puts us at February 6th for the open date, and then that round will be open until June 5th at 5 p.m. And if charter schools are interested in applying on their own, the last day to notify a school district of their intent to do so for new construction will be May 5th. So we also will be doing some webinars and workshops in the future. So we will be sending out email announcements and posting that information on our website once we've nailed down the dates and times for those workshops and other outreach opportunities. And then we did want to highlight in the consent portion of the agenda, we have the annual adjustment to the school facility program grants. And that was based on RS Means, which was adopted by the State Allocation Board as the index moving forward. And the increase over 2016 is 4.42%. So in the consent calendar, you will see the new grant chart listed with the grants calculated with that increase for 2017. And then also, per the government code, beginning March 1st, 2017, the threshold for track map extensions has been increased as well, and you can find that number in the board item. And then also just a brief mention, but we have a few emergency repair program projects moving through the process as well. You'll continue to see a few of those on the State Allocation Board agenda as we process project savings in that program and then reallocate to applications that have already been submitted. We are not accepting new applications, though, because we still have sufficient projects waiting for that savings that we will continue down that list. And then that takes us to the reports section of the agenda. And the first item that will be discussed is the Office of State Audit and Evaluation Report and Program Accountability. And this has been touched on briefly at the State Allocation Board. It was mentioned a few months ago as part of the Executive Officer Statement, and then board members mentioned it again in October. But the response at the time was that we needed to wait until after the outcome of Prop 51 was known to decide how we could best go about addressing the findings in the audit report. So now that we have the outcome of Prop 51, we are able to take some thoughts to the board and figure out the next steps. So this is mainly an introduction item to this topic. It's an overview of the report, the audit report itself, and the findings. And then we also are getting to some of the improvements that could potentially be placed in the program that we are recommending that we explore and come back to the board with an action item in the future. Some of the topics would include front-end grant agreements. We think that that would be an improvement to the program. Many other programs use grant agreements, and the goal of that is to provide greater clarity and transparency from the beginning in a document that you guys know that personnel switches over in school districts. These projects take 8 to 9 years, basically, from the start to the finish, to the point where we're asking you for supporting documentation. So ideally, somebody would be able to walk in, pick up a project file, read through a grant agreement instead of 100-plus pages of regulations, and know exactly what their responsibility is, what our responsibility is, some timelines, expectations, and ideally we're going to take the language up a level to make it a little easier to understand, and hopefully this will prevent any misunderstandings that will lead to future audit findings. So that is the goal, more transparency. We don't want any surprises at the end, just roles and responsibilities, who does what, when, and how. So that's the concept on that piece. And then for that, the report is asking the board to have us come back or acknowledge that we'll be coming back at a future board meeting with the grant agreement itself and then also regulations that would implement the grant agreements as well. Since the board is governed by regulations, we need to tie that in there somehow. So that would be topic of discussion today. We actually think that this will move pretty quickly. We have kind of a good idea of kind of the things that we want to see in the grant agreements, but we want to allow time for if we get any comments today from board members about certain areas that they want to highlight, but and we also want to see if there's any input from districts as well. So I think we're moving to a future meeting, but not too far out in the future, maybe a month, maybe 2 months. We're not expecting this to take not expecting this to take a year. So. Well, we are still exploring that as far as the timeline, because we need to see where our board members are at and when they want us to come back with this, and that's going to have an impact on how we structure that. But I would envision sort of how we've done in the past, where we've done work group meetings, stakeholder meetings, where we can hopefully present to you a good draft of what we are thinking and then get some feedback on things that we haven't thought of or where it doesn't work. Things we've completely missed. So that's been very helpful. We just did this a few months ago with the historic building regulations, and we got some great input from school districts that helped us really shape and define what those regulations looked like. Just some things that, you know, we handle the funding end of it. We don't know what a historic building, you know, what process is on the district end. So we found that really valuable. So we definitely want to get some input from folks in the field in case there's a piece of it that is perfectly clear to us, but makes absolutely no sense to you. The goal is for these things to be clear and easy to understand, so definitely want some feedback. Yeah, I'm not sure if we're going into the field or not. Again, the time frame is going to probably play a role in that. But even if we don't go into the field, we can do video conferences, conference calls, webcasts if we need to. But we'd like it to be a little more interactive. So, and obviously people can. Yeah, I think absolutely Sacramento's, you know, we're here and we can definitely hold a meeting on that. But we haven't fully decided how we reach the rest of the state yet. But we'll keep you posted on that for sure. No problem. How do you see this interacting with the existing allocation board regulations on audits? Complementary to the existing regulations, but maybe pulling out some of the pieces that are a little more obscure. We'd like to identify more what is expected and maybe some of the common areas that are troublesome. Document retention, for example, we'd like to put in there, you know, that we need the documents retained so that they can be reviewed in the future, because that seems to be a common point, is that it may very well be an eligible expenditure, but there's no documentation to support it because it got purged prior to the review piece of it. But there will need to be probably some clarity in the audit regulation section itself to incorporate the language with the grant agreements, but we're still in the draft stage, so I don't have specifics for you right now. Actually, Tom, can you repeat the question, because I missed the first part? But.
I don't know if I can remember it. Basically, so the funding agreement informs what the audit is going to be at the end. That's what I'm hearing you say.
Right. So the question was if the grant agreement, if the front-end grant agreement informs what the audit is going to be at the end. And yes, we'd like to clarify what we're looking for at the end of the process so that it's what we're looking for at the end of the audit should not be a surprise, because we're not looking for anything that's outside of the scope of statute or regulation. So ideally, the grant agreement is going to clarify pieces that we're already looking at, that we're already asking you for in letters, but we're asking you for them, you know, 6 years into the process. Instead, we'll put it in the grant agreement so that you know that in 6 years you're going to need to provide this information and that we are going to be checking certain things. Right, so the question was whether there's connection to the audit guide that was mentioned by the governor and whether it was going to be connected. And yes, that would be connected. So obviously the governor's message was that there needs to be some legislation to put in place the concept of the on-site audit or the field audit happening at the local level. So we are aware of that and watching how our process would interact with that. we would still see a role at the front end for us, because there are certain documents that we need to check statutorily to make sure that projects are proceeding for substantial progress. We check things at fund release, so there may be some interim pieces that we still need to do, but we'll have to wait and see what the legislation does as far as the responsibilities of the local auditors, and then we'll adjust accordingly. Okay. Were there any other questions on that report? Okay. And the next report, we have the, it's another overview item, and we are trying to provide our board members with a refresher on the various lists that are in the school facility program. So we talk about unfunded lists, and we throw the term around very loosely, but it has very different meanings, and the meaning is critical to understanding next steps on the projects. So this, again, is not an action item yet, because we are still missing a few board members. We don't have a full complement on the state allocation board yet, but we also wanted to let our board members know the history of the lists in case they weren't there at the time the regulations or the lists were created. We wanted to provide them an update with the number of applications and the funding that is requested on the various lists. And then, and I'll just give you a quick update on that, but for the, we have the three lists. We've got the unfunded list, lack of AB 55 loans, and those are the projects that are going through on the old bond funds right now, and they are waiting for cash from future bond sales to so that we can provide an apportionment and a fund release. So that process is in place. We don't need any further board decisions on that piece of it to keep functioning. The unfunded list, or what sometimes we refer to as the true unfunded list, that was that batch of projects that for about a 3-month time period, OPSC processed those applications fully based on the submitted documents, and those went to the board and got an unfunded approval on the unfunded list. That batch of applications, we've got about $178 million worth of new construction projects on that list, and $189-190 million in modernization projects on that list. So that's been processed, but the larger list, the applications received beyond bond authority or the acknowledged list, that's close to $2 billion worth of projects that have not yet been processed. So we are letting the board know of the size of those lists, and we also are letting them know that how we proceed on those lists needs further board direction and some policy decisions, because it's been since 2012 that these applications have been there, so things may have changed. And at the time these lists, well, at the time the acknowledged list was created, there wasn't really an anticipation that the program would continue on in its current format, so we need to check in with board members and see how they're feeling the next steps need to be. So we anticipate an action item coming to a future board meeting with some options and considerations for board members so that they can guide us on how we proceed with the batch of projects that we have in our office right now. Yes?
So if you go down that way with the grant agreements, are you going to go back into the applications beyond and apply that to those 650 applications?
So the grant agreements, the question was whether grant agreements would apply to the past applications that had been submitted. Did I capture that?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And we'll have to see what the board wants to do. There has been a large call for more accountability and oversight in the program in order to satisfy the audit and just make sure that we are doing everything we can to make sure that we're properly using the taxpayer funds. So that's definitely on the table, but we'll need to see where the board directs us to go with that. Any other questions on that one? Okay, and then just real briefly, we have one more report in there, which I'll let you read, because a lot of you have probably been involved in some of these bills, and I know that Cash provides updates, but we have our annual update on legislation that has passed in the past session. That typically this item relates to bills that have a direct impact on the program, but we also try to highlight for school districts anything that maybe it's just kind of nice to know that things have changed, whether it's for contracting requirements, how you're counting the students. We even have the bill that cleaned up what a skilled and trained workforce looks like. So just highlighting those in case you haven't seen this information in other venues, but these are the ones that we think are most important, either directly related to the program or somewhat related to the program that might be nice to know. So that is it for the board meeting. Any other questions for us? Okay.
So I'd like to thank Barbara. I think that most of us in the room would agree that we'd like some more clarity and transparency involved in the expectation of what's required of the district for that audit piece. And we welcome that conversation. And, of course, a lot of us will be there at the table to talk about that. And I did just want to pronounce Michael's last name one more time. Watanabe. I did it. I'm almost done as chair, and I learned how to pronounce his last name. But I digress. Okay, I don't think we have DSA here yet, so I am going to invite up. I think Fred Yeager is going to give us the California Department of Education update. Fred.
Well, good morning. A couple of updates on what's happening across the way. Water. We have all heard the troubles at Flint, Michigan on the quality water, and we also know that water is essential for health and student achievement. In 2009, Project Lean, which is a group of educators, found that kids don't drink enough water because the water's not cold, there are not enough drinking fountains, and the code says, was it 1 per 150? To meet plumbing code. So an elementary school of 600 kids has 4 drinking fountains per code. Seems a little light. And that the drinking fountains are dirty and poorly maintained. So there are barriers to students getting water. Some are using filling stations to fill up your water bottles to do that. There are a couple of resources that have been made available recently. The last few months, we've talked about the $9.5 million made available in the budget for water projects at impoverished communities. So that was from small disadvantaged communities. So that's the term, and there's a specific designation of what that is. And it's a focus on installation of water bottle filling stations, replacement of drinking fountains. So the guidelines for that program should be coming out in February, and that is administered by the State Water Resources Control Board. So you can go onto their webpage at waterboards.ca.gov, and maybe a search term could be SB 828 or Drinking Water for Schools program. I think you can also link to it off our webpage under What's New. Recently, the State Water Boards announced that their public school districts may ask their water providers to test up to 5 fixtures at their school for lead. Right. So the district must make a written request to their community water system provider, and then the system must make the collections within 3 months and report the results back to the school within 2 business days. So that extend program, it's a one-time program that extends until November 1st, 2019. So take a look at that. That is State Water Resources Control Board, and also I believe it was Twitter, whatever you do with Twitter on, our Twitter account mentioned it, so you can see. Check it out there also, and under our What's New.
Just to clarify, my understanding is that testing at the faucet, not at the source.
Right, right. Oh, to clarify that, this testing is at your faucet, your point of service, not the quality of the water coming into you from the provider. So when you turn the faucet on, what comes out, that's where the testing happens, at up to 5 locations on your school. And that's a free-to-use service from your local water provider. Okay. A couple other things. As many of you have heard, we are updating Title V and have been holding a number of stakeholder meetings throughout the state. We had a good one yesterday at a cash event. We've been to several county offices up and down the state, and I believe we have a big to-do in Bakersfield coming up soon. It's probably the Bakersfield is all a Twitter over it, I'm sure. on Jenny's last day. So take a look at on our webpage for Title V, get some background. We have a presentation archived. We're looking at ways, does Title V need to be amended and changed in any way to support the design of flexible and educationally adaptable schools? Yeah. So give us some ideas. And we're taking all ideas, whether they end up as a Title V change or a policy change, or some may require legislation. Send us your ideas. We'll take that up. And that delves in nicely to, because I was looking at Michael, who was supposed to write Title V, and then he quit. whatever. we are in the process of hiring for the consultant positions at the state. It's a two-step process. The process that is out now is the exam. It was released last week and is open till next Friday, the 7th, whatever next Friday is. Folks successful on that exam list would be contacted for hiring interviews when we get to the point of filling positions. So in general, the qualifications, you can get the details off our webpage. A master's in a field of public administration, business administration, urban planning, or a teacher's credential, and then 3 years of experience in the field. And check out the webpage for greater details on that. And I think that's all I have. Michael, I miss anything? This is. So, any questions? Well, Jeff from Fresno asked about the career tech money, the funding round within the bond, $500 million, similar to the last Prop 1D. The opening of that round is a call of the allocation board to set those, and I don't know where they are in that. But one of the things that is, a key part of that program is the preparation of a program statement that is scored by our CTE staff, which requires some timelines and some commitments for the updating of that application, which we are working with our career educational staff on now so that we are ready to go when there's an application period. And as I think many of you did that before, there's about a three-month period, 3 to 4 months, where CTE will score the applications and submit those with a passing score to OPSC for consideration in the next step. We are also, there are some comments as to how that worked. I know some of the concerns last time were that the application period was during the summer, and sometimes it's hard to get a hold of staff to help develop the program statements. So, we're aware of those, and we are trying to make sure that the application period allows ample opportunity for the academic staff to be closely involved. So the short answer is that's an allocation board decision as to when that timeline is, but we're getting prepared. That's the planning and the planning division name. Anything else?
They were easy on you today.
Yeah. Tom?
Where's Tom?
Tom? he beat me up yesterday.
I know. We did. Yeah, quite a few questions. The Title V reform, look, you said the last time that was done was 2000? Is that right? So, it's time to revisit that. I encourage you all to participate and look at those and make comment to CDE in that process. So Chet hasn't joined us yet. So we'll go ahead and move on to our legislative and regulatory update with Ian and Rebecca. And then I understand, Joe Dix, you're not going to update? Okay.
Change of plans.
All right. So welcome, Rebecca Cleary.
Thank you, Jenny. Hi, everyone. Good morning. So yesterday was a fun day at the state capitol. The governor gave his penultimate State of the State address, and he used the time to really focus on setting up a showdown between the federal government and California. Typically, the State of the State address is used to set forth policy priorities that he would plan to put into the legislative process, work with policymakers on. But really, he used the time to say, to draw a line in the sand on reinforcing California's commitments to things like climate change, the protection of undocumented folks and immigrants, healthcare reform, ACA, and the impact that a change at the federal level could have on California's budget. He also mentioned support for an infrastructure plan. So there's talk at the federal level, and I don't want to steal the thunder of CSF if they're here today, but talk at the federal level of a potential infrastructure program of up to $1 trillion. Schools could be a part of that. But the governor also really called on Californians to be Californians first, so maybe a little play on America First, and to really bring both sides of the aisle together to work on issues for the greater good of Californians. But really a very strong message is that there's uncertainty that stems from federal actions, and that uncertainty impacts our state budget. So the governor issued his budget proposal on January 10th, and the proposal is actually proposing to spend a little bit less money than we did last year, $122.5 billion as opposed to $122.7 billion last year. The governor is saying that the tide of revenues has begun to turn, that we're entering a slower period of growth. He's not using the word recession, but he's saying that growth appears to be slowing down. And a big part of this is also the uncertainty that's coming from the federal level. We don't know how policy changes at that level will affect the California budget. So he's estimating that we'll have about a $1.6 billion deficit absent corrective action. And his proposals, big picture, are really to roll back some of the one-time spending commitments that we've seen in the last couple of years, and to also slow and avoid spending increases in programs where possible. So it's not a doomsday scenario, but there's a lot of uncertainty. As far as education goes, he's providing additional dollars to the implementation of LCFF, about $744 million. That essentially keeps us at the current year level of implementation at 96%, still on target for full implementation in 2020-21. But I will say to you that in our conversations with our other friends and colleagues with schools, that there is a feeling that we're now actually entering a period of cuts again for schools. The term used yesterday in a meeting was schools are in cut mode again. So again, not a lot of real great optimism on the general education budget. On Proposition 51 and the implementation there, Barbara spoke about it. Tom also mentioned it in his questions. But there were two pieces in the budget that the governor spoke about, looking for some changes to accountability provisions in the school facility program. Once those changes are in place, he said that he would support the expenditure of Proposition 51 bond dollars. And we see that backed up in the budget where there is about $304 million set aside for a bond sale in the fall of 2017. Cash is working to expedite the process on those two accountability measures. Again, that front-end grant agreement that Barbara mentioned. And then the proposal on the back end, which would be to take expenditures and add expenditures for state bond dollars to the K-12 annual audit guide. This is not a new idea. The audit subcommittee of the State Allocation Board has looked at this issue. A number of stakeholders have looked at this issue. It's resuscitating an idea that's been out there for a while. And again, as Jenny mentioned, Cash absolutely supports accountability and transparency. So we'll be working closely with policymakers OPSC, State Allocation Board, Department of Finance on this so that we can get that done and move forward with implementing Proposition 51. And we do know that a lot of that can be done in regulation, the grant agreement, and likely trailer bill on the audit guide piece. So I won't steal the thunder on energy or some of these other things that were in the budget, but did just want to mention to you a little bit about the process and where we go from here. So budget typically is, it kicks off with the governor's proposal, which we saw on January 10th, and really that's where the governor puts down a marker to begin negotiations and conversations. So we are now entering the budget season where we'll have subcommittee hearings, with the members of the legislature, agencies and departments that are affected come to those meetings, talk about what the proposal would mean to them. Stakeholders, obviously Cash and others in the education community will be there as well. And the deadline to pass the budget is June 15th, and I have every expectation that the legislature will meet that deadline. They don't get paid if they don't, so they've got an incentive there. And it's really important to note that the May revision, which is where the governor updates his budget proposal based on updated revenue numbers and other figures, that happens in mid-May. That's really going to give us a more realistic picture of where we are with the budget. So really, stay tuned for that. Right now, it's all a lot of guesswork because of the federal uncertainty and other things. So May is when we'll see more real solid numbers. So I'm going to stop there, see if there's any questions that I can answer. All right, great. Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Rebecca. Nice job. Always very concise and to the point, which I appreciate. We're going to welcome up. We're joined by our state architect, Chet Whittem. I'm going to welcome him back up, get on the right slide. Whoops. Other way. Try to get to the right. Ta-da! There you go, sir. The floor is yours. This is the recording for the webcast, and we're just using our loud voices today.
Okay,
so welcome,
you,
sir.
Good to see you. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. It's cold out there. I've got to warm my hands up a little bit. It's cold in one respect, but it's hot in the other. Obviously, we've got a lot of hot issues that are affecting us and affecting you. I can tell you right now that it's my understanding, and based upon the 5 years I've been here, but prior, that DSA's never been in a better position to handle the challenges that we've got ahead of us. And there are some serious, serious challenges. Obviously, a great opportunity with a lot of bonds passed and a lot of new work that can come through, but we're stuck with a system where, in terms of staffing, we cannot really do any major increasing in our staffing. So how are we going to handle an onslaught of a large amount of work? We're doing a number of things, and we're preparing ourselves already. Let me start by saying that we had moved from 10, 12 weeks of bin time, whatever number of years ago, down to 5 or 6 weeks. Actually, we were hitting 4 weeks in many cases. A bin time, by the way, is just that, for those of you that don't know that famous term, is really the queue before we actually start doing a review of a project. Well, we had moved it down to 5 or 6 weeks, as I said, and I have made a goal, set a goal, that by the end of the first quarter of this year that we would move it down to 4 weeks. And we started by going outside and contracting out with a large number of consultants to do structural and now a structural plan review. We've already assembled a group for access, and we're looking to go out to find architects and fire specialists to do fire life safety. And we believe that that's pretty much under control. In the meantime comes December, and as many times as I've said to everybody, there are no serious, significant code changes. We received $1.6 billion worth of work in the month of December, and add that to the $400 million that was already, plus, that was already sitting in the bin with our 5 week bin time, and we've got $2 billion worth of work that is there looking towards plan review. That's terrific. However, we got to get the work out. So we've gone with a series of consultants, outside work. We are looking to go out for some retirees and have them come back in to assist us. And there aren't too many of them that are going to be available, but that's going to be in the cards as well across the state. And our staff is going on overtime. So right at this particular time, we're seeing this peak of what could be 10, 11 weeks of bin time. We think that that'll go back down, and our intention is to be back to the 4 weeks of projected bin time by the month of of April, the end of the first quarter. Historically, what's happened is every 3 years, when there's a code cycle, December goes sky high, and then January and February drop down really low and level out. And we see that already happening, and it will happen here. So if you spread it out across the three-month period, we think we're going to be in pretty good shape to handle the issues. We are moving into not just plan electronic back check review, but we're actually starting to do full projects in electronic. We've done well over 100 of the back checks already. We're beginning to push even harder, training both our people, as well as trying to collaborate with the architects and the engineers outside, who are admittedly far ahead of us from a standpoint of electronic use. But it's going rather smoothly, in some cases taking a little extra time. But it is going relatively smooth, and we're beginning to pick it up. And we think at the end of the day, it's going to be valuable for all of us. I will say, in terms of trying to reduce, let me step back a second. We have an intake process where we review all projects to make sure that they, in fact, meet the requirements of the submission. Because for a long time, I, in practice, put in a lot of dummy sets to get in line. DSA has stopped that by having an intake process to review and make sure that it is a complete set. And when you come in with $2 billion worth, or an additional $1.6 billion worth of work, you can imagine, how are we going to get that through that first intake process? So we turn around and we need to get it in there, so we're pulling many of our plan reviewers off to do the intake process, which is terrific. We're going to get that done. However, they're no longer doing plan review. So it's a three-dimensional chess trying to move this stuff around, but it's well under control at this particular point. Moving forward, we see some other issues that need to be addressed. One of them that I think is probably on all of your minds is this issue of the four-year limitation on projects that have been submitted. That is to say, you have 1 year after a project is approved to start construction, with a potential of three additional extensions. We don't think that's going to work. We've got, I presume, a number of projects in your area that you want to get started on, and they could be over the four-year period. We're trying to figure out how to do that and how to do it logically. From a philosophical standpoint, just this is a philosophical, this is not regulatory or process at all, but from a philosophical standpoint, if there's been no change in the structural requirements, who cares what the year is? We only care that it meets the code and that it, in fact, is going to be a safe building. But we're going to have to find some deadline or some period of time. We can't just leave that open, because that would be a discussion by each one of you in discussions with our plan reviewers. So we're trying to look at alternatives, and we're going to probably pull together a task force that we're going to ask you to participate with us on, to how we can do this in a logical way. We do have to change the regulations to do this. And that's going to be an issue, because it appears to me that we might have to go in for an emergency change in the regulations. And that's not an easy thing to do, because you got to prove emergency. So what's the emergency here? That's going to be a tactical issue, or a strategic issue, really, that we're going to have to work out. But we are focused on that rather clearly. The second issue that we're going to be hitting soon is the issue of inspectors, and we're already hearing from a number of the major inspection organizations that they are having trouble keeping the work going because they are not enough inspectors. Now, the inspectors, 8 years ago, 9 years ago, as you know, were making lots of money from you because the market, the demand was high. At the same time, we were trying to raise the standards of our inspectors. And so we want to do a relook at those standards and determine what we can do from a standpoint of the inspectors to alleviate the problem, because a year from now or 18 months from now, when those projects are really under construction, we're going to need to make sure that you've got good inspectors and that they're available. And we're also seeing, we did a little chart, and it looks like there's a lot of them in retirement age, or at least that period where you think you're going to lose a group, and we want to really alleviate those issues. But we don't have an answer for it yet. Let's see. The other issues, I want a little bit about certification. 16,386. You all know I say that number all the time because that's the number that was given to me when I walked on board. I am very pleased to say that we are at about 7,200 now. So we've been able to really knock that number down dramatically, and we're really proud of that at DSA. And you should be proud of that, because we just pulled this stuff together. You folks did a lot of the work, and we appreciate that. We still have a long way to go, and there's a lot of things that we can do, and we're trying to be as proactive and aggressive as possible in that particular area. The other side is the inspection card installed in 2013. I am incredibly proud of the fact that we are running 93 to 94% certification on our projects. And I believe actually, and we're trying to figure out how to do this number, I believe that actually a whole bunch of those projects that are uncertified, the 6 or 7%, actually do get certified. They just didn't make it in the 120 days that we had established, the two periods. They might get certified a month later, or they might get certified a couple months or at the end of a year after that. So we're really reaching very close to what our goal is, which is to get all of our buildings totally certified. So that, I think we can all take a great deal of satisfaction in that particular piece. From a standpoint of our staffing at DSA, we're in July of last year, a raise was given to the plant, to the architects and the engineers, dependent upon staying at DSA until the end of June of this year in terms of their retirement, their pensions. So we anticipate a significant number of architects and engineers that will be retiring in July of this year, which is going to put a negative on us in the sense that we will be down in staff, but an incredible positive because we've got an opportunity to recruit the next generation. It's compounded by the fact that we want to overlap, and we've got the permission to overlap. We want to start hiring in advance so that they can learn, and we don't lose momentum. The negative in that whole piece is that many of these people have time on the books that is going to burn for anywhere from 3 months to 6 months to 8 months, and that's all money coming out of our pocket. So it becomes a difficult one for us to maintain our budget. But it's not your problem. I'm just trying to let you know that there is this change that's going to happen, and we already have a number who have already signified to us that they are retiring. So we've got a number of supervisors across the state that are going to be retiring. Again, positive. We get to bring younger people in. Some of the plan reviewers can move up to be supervisors. That's terrific. But we have to backfill behind them. So our HR department, the internal HR department, is working very hard. And interestingly enough, we have three people in HR, one of them retired in December. So we're not only having to do work, but we're having to find another HR person. I think we've got that one put together, but it'll take some time for him to get up to speed and to start understanding all the things that we're doing. So I think that's it in terms of what we are doing right now. Things are going well. The question is, do you have any questions, and are there any issues that you want to talk about? Yeah, who's that guy over there? I'm sorry, Mr. Fluffy, is it? Tom Fluffy? Sorry, hold on. I tried to turn this off before, and I didn't get it turned off. Go ahead. It's Mr. Trump? I'm sorry. No. Yeah, I'm making America great.
So thank you for addressing that 4-year limitation. And thank you again, because it's great to have a very short conversation with somebody of your stature and your authority.
I'm only 5'9". It's going to take some time, but I need some help from you folks. And that is it one project that we're worrying about? Or is it 550 projects? I need to have some, because we're going in, whatever we do, we're going to have to go in for an emergency set of regulations. And I need to walk in with some facts. So I would say to Cash, it's your obligation, if you want this to happen, to come to us with a number of projects here. There's 72 projects that are, you know, whatever, $750 million or whatever the amount of cost is, and they're all sitting ready to go. We need to know about that. So you need to start that immediately if in fact we're going to make this thing happen. I am around tomorrow, but I don't know whether I like that question. Yeah. I'm in Sacramento tomorrow.
But get another phone call.
Okay. Anything else? Okay, guys. Thank you very much.
Thanks,
Jenny.
I appreciate it. We're always glad to hear about your success with project completion and
our
success.
You turned around yesterday and said the TSA is holding.
You have your spies out looking out at me.
Jenny, you need to look at the scorecard.
Yeah,
I
know. Hey, I
told.
All right, got it. Ah, busted. Darn it. You have some loyal staff, that's for sure. Good. All right, so moving back to ledge updates, we have Ian here. And I just wanted to say that the capacity issues that Chet's talking about, obviously we're all experiencing those. So we can see where, you know, we need to increase capacity in all the agencies as well as at the district level and in all of our architectural firms. And we may all be fighting for the same people. So I think it's a really good time to have an architectural or engineering degree, don't you? Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Welcome back.
I'll let you work that out among yourselves. Yes, thank you, Jenny, and thank you, everybody. Yes, so I wanted to, first of all, follow up on what Jenny just said, and also Rebecca and I were talking as the state architect was talking, and one of the things that we wanted to mention about the budget is that the budget does not include increases for the key implementing agencies, for right, DSA, CDE, and so on. So just rest assured, that is a key, we're very well aware of that, and that's a key part of our strategy in terms of implementing. We know that all the high-minded policy discussions are important, but it comes down to a capacity to process those projects, and so we're well aware of that. We were talking about that as well, so thank you for that. Also, I wanted to mention before I get into my main presentation, don't worry, it's not going to be that long. Sounds a little scary, but the Legislative Advisory Committee is meeting today in the Cash office at 12:30. We do have lunch, and one of the things that's going to happen there is that Tom Duffy is going to be there, and we're going to be talking more in-depth about some of the implementation issues. We didn't want to take the time here, but we'll be able to get more into those, the agency issue and many others, so you're certainly welcome to attend that. Quickly, I did want to, and we'll be getting this posted, I just wanted to do a little quick pitch for the Cash Maintenance Network program at the annual conference. As you know, the interest and significance of M&O is continuing to rise in our organization and in particular, and we have a really good, I think, program, and we're going to put those out so you can look just at those. Certainly Julie Strauss, and who is here today, and Don Siegler, who is not. They're the co-chairs of our committee and have done a really good job. Just quickly, I won't get too much into it, but CASH does have a FIT committee. We're taking a look at the FIT guidebook. We're working hard on that. We got a lot of folks working on particular pieces of that, and at the conference, we'll talk kind of about where we are on that. You can definitely look forward to that. That's a key document, and we're excited about some of the things I think we're doing with it. It's going to be a much better document, more relevant. Yes.
So you're talking about linking LCFF.
That is exactly right. That's basically the mission of the committee is basically. Moving from what we call from a Williams world to an LCAP world, right? Williams used to govern most of the things that we did in M&O. Now a lot of those Williams pieces have been put into the LCFF, and so there's more, you know, it's just a little bit different. So as far as I know, some of the agencies are working, or the only ones working on that. So this will be, when it's done, I think a pretty significant reference document for the industry. So we're excited about that. So now to the exciting part of the, you know, I always talk about the exciting things. I did want to talk a little bit about a couple of key issues that will be key for M&O and will be key for school facilities in general, and that is managing toxics and natural resources. And what I'm going to talk about is just a little bit of mix of legislation and regulatory issues. First of all, as you know, the stormwater permit, thanks to largely the advocacy work that CASH did, provided a 5-year non-designation for schools. Now, that's the good news. The bad news is that's going to run out. They're already re-looking at the permit, and schools will be included in it. The good news is that I'm speaking with some of the water board staff already. They want to hear what would be helpful to schools. So I'm trying to put a committee together to go talk to them, just like we did before. So that's good news. We think we'll have a pretty significant influence on what that can be. But we hope that there's a school-specific piece there to make it easier for districts. On the legislative front, it's a little bit worrying. I was given some language that is being shopped around that would require a lot of our implementing agencies, DSA, CDE, others, to review for stormwater. And so we think that is premature. Our argument is, why don't we let this permit go forward, which governs the whole stormwater. We see that as putting the cart before the horse. So frankly, we are working with the author of that to try to snuff that bill out. We'll see how it goes. So stormwater, again, is going to be a big issue. And there is money at the water board for that. I know CDE is working with the water board to put that program together. So that's some good news, and we'll have more information about that. The other issue is PCBs. You've heard some of that, the Santa Monica Malibu issue. The concern there is really if it spreads more statewide, and we know some of that concern has already done that. What we've done, I've been working with Toni Stein, who is one of the attorneys that litigated that case, and she has now agreed to do a workshop at the CASH conference, which is kind of a big coup. That'll be on Tuesday, and we'll be posting that. So if you're at all interested in that, or think you might be, take a look at that. And I think they're trying to get someone from the district as well as kind of a case study. So it should be pretty good. You heard the CDE representative talk about this these new provisions for lead testing, and so. There's two components to that. There's a grant program, and then there's the lead testing. The lead testing. Basically, schools, as Fred indicated, would be able to request that the water is tested. So we're going to, I have a draft article from an attorney that's going to explain that, and we'll post that on the CASH website. Jenny and I talked just a little bit offline about that. The only comment I want to make of that is we it's a good program. I think we better be very thoughtful about how we approach utilizing that, right? I think, yeah, I see a lot of heads already bobbing. That's great stuff, but just identifying problems without a plan or without secure funding, you know, existence of a grant program is good, but, you know, something closer to being funded, that's all I'd say right now. Certainly we'll be incorporating, we'll do some, incorporate this into some of the CASH workshops to delve into this a little bit deeper.
In other words, in plain language, you got to be prepared to address an issue if it's found.
Yes, that's the translation from the lobbyist, yes, exactly, thank you, yeah. So, and that just came through this week. It's a pretty big deal. The next one, this is just for your information. About 3 years ago, AB 1828 passed, and that had to do with increasing what schools have to do for recycling. So, unbeknownst to us, there may be a facilities component to that. We're already speaking again with the Water Board about that. They're the implementing agency on that. And it may have to do with needing more space for some of the bins and so on. So a working group has been formed, and I'm representing CASH on that. The last one is a new bill has been introduced, AB 68 Mathis. And that has to do with this issue and this issue that you heard from me and others last year about schools' proximity to farms and applications of toxics. So as you know, the Department of Pesticide Regulation last year had some regulations. We, CASH, other education organizations weighed in somewhat negatively on that. Lo and behold, there's a bill this year that has been introduced in the regulations. It's not to get too technical about it, but it's the proximity radius is we got them down to a mile. In this one now, it's back up to 2 miles, right, which is going to incorporate a lot. So you see we're going back and forth here. So keep your ears and eyes peeled on that one. We will certainly engage on that as well as others. We already have calls into the Farm Bureau who I'm not sure, but it makes all the sense in the world. They're the sponsor of this, so we'll certainly start to work with them. We may have some more help. Some of the other education organizations are more interested in this issue as well as these other issues, which is good news for CASH. A lot of times we're up there the sole person waving the red flag, but frankly, to their credit, some of the other organizations are starting to work with us, and that's good news. So unless there's any questions about that, is there any questions? Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Nice job. So Ian, he gets to deal with all the fun stuff like refuse and stormwater and all of that, and we certainly appreciate it. One thing that I would make note of with the pesticide application is that does impact, obviously, your ability as a district to look at and secure sites. We're actually, I'm starting a process of looking at a buffer zone and maybe having to in the Central Valley. We can afford the land, but buy more land maybe than we really need because our farming community is concerned about their ability to continue to practice, you know, their farming technique and that kind of thing. So that's a concern, I think, and we'll be talking about that with Farm Bureau and others. All right, so I'd like to welcome up our illustrious vice chair, soon to be chair, any second now, Don Ulrich, for the annual conference.
Thank you.
Would you go ahead?
Hello, everyone. You know, with resources and funding in the air, and, you know, hearing today that we got cooperation from agencies, CDE and OPSC to work with us to get these dollars out to our kids, it's exciting. And, in fact, one of our board members today said it's like blood's in the water. And I don't know if he's comparing us to sharks or what, but as a school district employee, if our kids and the environment they're in with teachers is at stake, I'm happy to be a shark, you know, and get the money out and get this money out to kids as soon as we can. And it's good to hear from the departments and the agencies that we have there, that they're working with us to get the dollars out. The conference is, where's Jenny took the call? Here it is. I'll just, one. There we go. 4 weeks are left, and that excitement I just referenced is really great for the conference. It will be the largest conference in probably the last 7 or 8 years. The hotels are sold out, so if you still want to go, you're going to have to contact hotels in the area and make your reservations there. Registration is 14% above where it was this year, last time at this year, so that's great news. The trade show is sold out. Limited sponsorships are still available, so if you're with a firm that'd like to participate, the one that we specifically are looking for is a sponsor for the app. There's a phone app that we started a few years ago that's used by a lot of people that attend the conference, and that if you're interested in sponsoring that, you can see Mr. Golick, myself, or Lisa if she's here today, or you know, a cash staff member, and we'll get you hooked up to do that. I just think the other important part about the conference is, you know, that excitement's in the air and a lot of questions and, you know, apprehension, but excitement about what's going to happen. You know, the agencies will be there reporting like they have in the past. And that's really that what Dr. Duffy, our, you know, lobbyist is doing, is staying in contact with them really on a daily basis. So it changes rapidly. So being at this conference, you know, attending and doing the sessions you normally do, but also paying attention to what the agencies are saying at that time of the year, a month from now, I think is going to be important and inform you and your district and your firms on what's going on, you know, kind of the latest news, which is always good to have. So unless there's any questions or comments or concerns about the conference, I'll turn it over to, no questions, to Anna Ferrara to give us an update on the energy work she's doing.
Can we wait and see what the weather is? I'm such a fair weather golfer, sorry. Hey, Morgan, you still with us? Right on, okay. So I know this information is very, very interesting. Okay, so energy. We had a great news from the governor's office in this last January proposal. We saw an increase in the money that is going toward the Clean Energy Jobs Fund for 17-18. It moves in an upward direction over last year, and that's the second time it's done that, so we're really pleased to see that. Clean Energy Jobs Fund, of course, funds the Prop 39 school energy program. So as was mentioned, these are the opening numbers. There will be discussions back and forth between the legislature and the governor, so we need to stay on top of that and make sure that it stays or even goes up. We will again make the point that this is very important program for schools, and that the corporate tax revenue numbers should also be going up. So we appreciate to see that number. It's $422.9 million in 17-18 to support school districts and charter school energy efficiency projects in 17-18. This represents a $24 million increase over 16-17 for K-12 ADA grants. Community colleges will also receive a little bit of a bump up. $3 million increase over the 49.3 we saw last year. So it's $52.3 million for community colleges. SEC, as I said, will continue to work on these issues and make sure that the funding stays at least static. We're going to be spending some time sharing information with the legislature and the governor about the good work we're doing with the funding that's been done, that's gone out so far. And discussing what's next for schools with regard to energy efficiency and renewables. We may be asking for individual project information. In fact, I'm sure that we'll be asking for that. We've got some, but we'd love to have more so we can go across the street and talk to them about what's going on in their specific districts, especially as we start to look at the program wrap-up and what will happen after that. CEC has sent out a friendly reminder earlier this month talking about Prop 39. There's been a few changes. They're reminding us about the sole source, not to use a sole source process to award funds. They also point to the Public Resources Code 26235C that says specifically, that talks about the sole source process, basically that we're not supposed to use one. And also that 2620060 that says all projects shall require contracts that identify the project specifications, cost, and projected energy savings. We all know this, but you know, they're reminding us that those things must be in the contracts and ready for accounting and auditing at the end. In February, they're saying that a new certification will appear in the Energy Expenditure Plan application that says the LEA commits to following all contract requirements in the Prop 39 guidelines, including not using a sole source process to award funds and providing a clear and accurate description of the eligible energy projects in all contracts. So that will be in February. So to ensure the encumbrance of Prop 39, as I've, you know, informed you earlier, August 1st is the new deadline for all energy expenditure plans to be submitted. And to address the fact that they've done this in the fourth year of a five-year program, they are asking for a one-year extension of that encumbrance date. That request has gone to the governor's office. We are carefully looking for it as the budget goes through. We'll be mentioning it in every hearing. We're hoping that it will be addressed in trailer bill language, but we have not heard anything specific confirming that that will occur. So we need to continue to be vigilant to see that that one-year extension gets done. We're also working on some legislative language just generally and looking for authors, so I'll keep you posted on that. CDE has also posted a revised entitlement schedule for 2016-17, and that is on their Prop 39 webpage. Let's see, what else? For LEAs with completed EEPs, a final project completion report will be made available on the Prop 39 Energy Expenditure Plan online system 12 months after the project completion date. Once you're complete, your project is complete, you must provide a final report on that. And so all of those other elements about the sole source and savings need to be included in that report. So that is also done through CEC on their website. Finally, School Energy Coalition will be having a general membership meeting during that CASH annual conference. It will be held on February 20th from 2:15 to 3:45. We'll be sending out an agenda later this week. We'll have some speakers of interest that will elaborate on some of the things I've just told you, along with an outline of our, a more detailed outline of our advocacy efforts with the legislature, the CEC, and the CPUC. So if you're at the CASH conference and would like to attend, you do not have to be a member. We encourage you to come join us on February 20th at 2:15. Our spring forum, forums are scheduled for May 18th in San Diego and May 23rd in Sacramento. We look forward to seeing you there, and we have a lot of work to do as we look to extend the program and make sure that that one-year extension gets done. So thank you very much. Are there any questions about Prop 39 or SEC? No? Okay. And water, CDE mentioned the drinking water piece. It's been raining, so see that that's probably not a huge issue, but we'll be watching those irrigation building code standards going through. Thank you.
Don't we all have a sense that even though we're kind of, I guess, coming out of the drought this year, nobody expects that we're going to go back to the way we were handling water prior to the great drought, do we? Okay. All right. Thanks, Anna. I'd like to welcome up Dave Walrath. He's going to give an update on California's for
Let's go. You're right there. Yeah. And this is some exciting stuff, what's going on nationally. And of course, we've got the thumb right on the latest news. So tell us what it is.
Thank you, Jenny. $1 trillion kind of rolls off the tongue. You know, I have a problem imagining a million, much less a million, which is $1 trillion. California's school facilities lobbies the federal government for federal funding for school facilities. We've been successful in the past with funds for qualified zone academy bonds, for qualified school construction bonds, as well as direct appropriations for maintenance. The Senate came out yesterday with their proposal for $1 trillion, which contains $75 billion for school facilities, a mixture of formula allocation as well as expansion and modifications of QZABs, qualified zone academy bonds, which are tax credit bonds. That's $7.5 billion a year. If California gets its fair share, we're going to be somewhere around $800 to $850 million a year. Not chump change.
Here, let me play some music for you.
Yay! This is the Democratic proposal. As you know, the Democrats are not in the majority in D.C. President Trump came out with his first series of proposed infrastructure projects. Many of them were already in the pipeline, about $137 billion. If he stays on his $1 trillion number, and I think he will, that leaves somewhere in the neighborhood of $863 left to go. All of these are exciting. We'll be going back to D.C. in the middle of May, somewhere in the first or second week, most likely the second week of May, to do our lobbying. We'll probably go back again in the fall. We encourage you all to participate in that. The more people advocating for school facilities and federal school facility funding, the better it is. One point that was raised is, well, who cares about what the Democrats said? The reality is it's the Senate, and the Senate needs 60 votes. Republicans have 52. They need 8 Democrats. So for the president to get his proposal, he needs Democratic votes. For the Democrats to include in their proposal schools means schools will be on the table as part of a federal infrastructure plan. So we'll be asking you for information about how fast you could spend money on potentially modernization, repair, renovation, as well as other programs, and how well you could access qualified zone academy bonds. Exciting time. Once again, $1 trillion. I think that's great. I'm with him all the way. I'm with the governor. Go for it, guy. We're with you on the infrastructure piece. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Jenny, but want to say something as Jenny's coming up. Jenny, thank you. Thank you for everything you've done. This is the last monthly meeting you'll be presiding over as Chair of Cash. So thank you. I want to congratulate you.
Thank you, sir.
Great job.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. So what a great thing to go out on, right? Trillion with a T, billion with a B, $9 billion for state. Good times, a lot of work ahead of us. Where's the clicker? I think those are all the updates we had. Job exchange and People's Choice, now's your chance to say you need licensed architects. Anybody flying any positions they want to talk about? School district? No? All right, well, make sure to watch the cash updates and the cash register. Those are good forums for jobs and advertising. And I want to make one comment about the conference. I know we're running late, but we are really impacted, which is a good thing. We're going to have a lot of folks, a lot of new faces at this conference. We are going to focus heavily on 101, construction 101 and planning 101. So if you know people who you know, aren't familiar with the organization and aren't familiar with what we offer, please encourage them to attend those, because that's what we do best as an organization, is we help train and educate and get the information out. So thank you for being here, and we'll see you soon.